BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Hello, good afternoon. Welcome to another edition of New Arts Alive. I am your host tonight. I'm Ron Schira, sitting in for James Carroll. With me, I have a very special guest. This is Joe Szimhart, who is an artist at the Goggle Works and in independent artist, also you're somewhat of a counselor, right? You work as a...
Well, I have a long history in a maverick field of deprogramming or exit counseling people out of cults, and I started that back in 1985, so yeah. I still do some of that work.
Yep. Well, it's a pleasure to have you here.
Sure.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for being my guest. So, Joe, tell us about yourself, a little bit about you, about
okay. Joe. I was born in 1947 in Germany. My parents are Hungarian. We came over here when I was 3 years old in the U.S., and I learned to speak English about age five. I've always been interested in visual arts and that kind of expression. I'm not sure where it comes from. My grandfather on my mother's side was an amateur artist and craftsman. I was an engineering student in college in Dayton, and I for whatever reason, decided to pursue this inner drive to be an artist, and I switched to an art major in 1967, and ever since then I've been pursuing the art field. I later got a degree from, a certificate actually, from the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts in Philadelphia in 1975. Mm-hmm. I moved out to New Mexico in Santa Fe after that, and lived there for about 18 years. I exhibited in galleries, I taught fine arts at the state penitentiary. Mm-hmm. I taught life drawing courses at St. John's College for a few years. And I basically was hacking around trying to make a living. I did portraits on the plaza in Santa Fe. Probably I counted, estimated around 7,000 heads I drew over those 14 years I did that. I did construction work. I did murals for a hospital there. You know, And I also got into this field you mentioned of exit counseling or helping people with cult problems, and I began to get known in that internationally. So my art career took kind of a back burner for a while. I produced, I exhibited in some shows, but it really took a rebooting, so to speak, when I joined the Goggle Works crowd up there, and I got a studio 207 and 2011, and that's been good for me because it's somewhere for me to go. It's a studio that I can always work, and since then I've been fairly productive. I also work in a psych hospital full time, so that keeps bread and butter coming into the family. But the art has been a lot of fun, and you know, the ideas keep coming, so I keep producing work.
You keep doing it.
Yep.
Well, I think your work is very exciting. I like the methodology of how you paint. You're not you use all oils, right?
Mostly, the last one that you saw at Noah and Moby, that's acrylic, but I do use oils probably 90% of the time.
So but you use them in almost a how would you say an editorial fashion. It's like some of your work has a lot of humor, and there's a lot of, you know, kind of irony to the work.
Right.
So.
There's an immediacy to the brushstrokes.
Yeah.
And I try not to labor over the final product. Once I get my ideas going, I finish them pretty rapidly, and so you can see a lot of work, the brush strokes on there, the action,
right,
in an expressionist way. But I still try to concentrate on anatomy or suggestive of anatomy when I'm using figures or animals or people.
Yeah, but once you get your point across, I mean, what is the good of over-laboring it?
Right, that's how I feel. I just want to get it done, get to the next thing.
Get to the next thing, right. Yep. So that's kind of, well, that's kind of what I like about your work is that it's immediacy and it's nonchalance, you know. Mm-hmm. So it has a nice flavor to it. Now we have a number of paintings that you brought in here on a thumb drive, so we can take a look at a few of those.
Sure.
If you'd like to put the first one up. Now you're going to have to tell me the titles on these.
Well, this one is Yellow Bird with Baby Rhino. It was inspired by a story I read a number of years ago about the rhino horn in the underground market. Its weight is that of gold. In other words, it was, so the yellow bird reflects this golden relationship that the rhino horn has, and as a result, these animals are getting slaughtered for this, you know, practically useless powder that they make out of it. But people think it gives them virility and whatever. It's very big in Asia, that kind of superstition, and so these things still sell there for high prices. But I kind of wanted to restore a sense of natural sensitivity to the rhinoceros by putting this little yellow bird to its.
It also has a certain reference as an aphrodisiac with works by Salvador Dali.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, Salvador Dali had a number of times put the rhino horn in his paintings as a way of creating like the artificial sexual.
Right. And of course Freud would have maybe agreed with him.
Yeah, Fred would most likely have agreed with him, yeah.
But anyway, what's interesting about this piece, it sold in a show at the Goggle Works to someone that just came back from Africa after seeing the rhinos, and they had a connection with it right away. So that was an interesting way to sell a painting, is to someone that feels what that means.
Well, it's always good to have someone have a connection.
Yes.
You know, with the artwork. I know how that is with me. I appreciate an artwork that you know, applies to me personally, that I can feel it. That, you know, is important to me. I have a whole house of little artworks that are very personal.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, I do that. Little house, not much room, but we have a good collection, yeah.
Oh, my house is a mess. You wouldn't even want to see it.
Okay.
Let's go to the next photo here.
All right, so this one's called Weapon Inspector. And again, it's a small painting, about 16 by 20 inches, but similar style as the previous one. Again, it came from the idea of reading an article about weapons inspectors in the Middle East, and immediately I got this image of what does that mean? It's kind of a dangerous job to go look for weapons, because you might step on one. So I put this bird peeking into the muzzle of it's actually a semi-automatic rifle, did it rather quickly, but tried to give it some sense of precarious balance.
It has this sense of innocence of danger, you know, so that you have something that's a deadly weapon here.
Right.
But you have a bird that really has no idea of what this is.
That's,
you
know, another way to look at it. Yeah.
So he'll sit on the end of it and he'll look inside of it. If it goes off, well, you know, he'll never know it. But the idea that I see there is kind of this the social aspect of it. Maybe I have to formulate this correctly in my head, but you don't know about guns until you're taught about them.
Right.
Yeah, so if you have this sort of experience with weaponry, then you know what it is. I mean, all of us, we look at it, we immediately know that it's a gun.
Right. You know, but a bird, it's a different thing.
Different thing. Yeah, it's obviously like a political, it's suggestive of other things, of mm-hmm. innocence, betrayed, mm-hmm. Children playing with mines in a village and it blows up, you know, not knowing what they are.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, or a child finds their parent's gun, you know.
That's the other thing, yeah. Yeah. Too many stories like that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yep.
So, okay, we'll move on to another the one. Next one.
I don't know how.
So there we go.
This is more recent. I did a series of, based on our kitchen chairs my wife and I bought in New Mexico a long time ago, and I like the shape of them, and so I did kind of silhouette studies. They're 48 inches tall, mm-hmm. and there's two of them there in this painting. Mm-hmm. Again, nothing profound, although they could be. For instance, the one on the right, the chair can be facing away from you or facing toward you, depending how you want to look at it. Mm-hmm. And you know, and again, to me, they're decorative as well as suggestive of points of view.
Right. So, well, I also like the abstract symmetry and the design of it, because mm-hmm. I mean, you can pretty much figure out if you're looking for what it resembles in reality. It's a chair, you know. Right. It looks like a chair, but it's a nice abstract form. Mm-hmm. You know, even if you wouldn't specify that it was a wooden chair.
Right. It's probably one of my more quieter paintings as far mm-hmm.
as far as that goes, right? Yeah.
Huh. They're more maybe zen-like, peaceful, not much mm-hmm. to rattle your mind.
Right. So but so in your painting, is this what you're going for, is the zen-like quality, or do you want to you want them to come across with some sort of meaning, or are they more personal meaning only to you?
I don't force the meaning. Mm-hmm. It sort of just happens, and the something emerges from the content when I put it together, and then the story begins. In other words, my narrative about what it's about happens after I put the painting down. Mm-hmm. I don't think about how to explain it ahead of time. So I just sort of like the images and mm-hmm. try to maybe put them in a complimentary or pleasing design. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have some idea that I'm saying something, but mm-hmm. I'm not trying to narrate it.
So you react intuitively to the design.
It is intuitive, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I think it's this kind of work, since the modern era relies a lot on these internal feelings. Kandinsky called it the internal necessity. Something mm-hmm. inside has to come out, mm-hmm. but it's not. It's in this other language. It's not in words. It's not in music. It's not in body movement, like in dance. This is something else. It's a visual language, and so you can. I think you can go into this kind of painting with these chairs, you know, or completely abstract work, mm-hmm. You know, it suggests something to the human mind. As some people get it, some people don't. It's an acquired taste, I think, mm-hmm. that kind of work.
Yeah. You know, I've heard it said, you know, that there's basically two kinds of art, two kinds of spirituality. So that if you have a painting, you have the creator of the painting as being outside of the artwork. Mm-hmm. So the painter is sort of like God, in a way, where he creates the environment for this painting to, like, live on its own.
Right.
Okay? Whereas the other type of art form is one that's incorporated into the artist itself, like a dancer, mm-hmm. you know? You can't have the dance without the dancer. Right. But once the artist, the painter, or the sculptor, completes the artwork, then the artist goes into the background and the artwork has a life of its own.
Right, right. Well, in another way, what thought just came to me is one of my early art teachers at the University of Dayton called that kind of work, or any kind of work, sort of frozen music, work on paintings, because once it's presented, there it is. It becomes an interaction between the viewer and that object, that piece of sculpture or that mm-hmm. music, however, has to be presented through time, and so does mm-hmm. dance. Whereas these things are frozen in time. Mm-hmm. There's a difference there, and maybe that's what makes painting so intriguing, is this captured time just stays there.
Mm-hmm.
And in a sense, when you think spiritually, we have rituals in churches, the bowing to the ground of Islam in submission, the raising of the Eucharist in the Catholic Church, the reading of the Torah, you know, and it goes on and on, the Buddhist chanting. Whenever someone in a religion goes back to a particular form that's repeated over and over again, what they're doing, I think, is freezing time. They're recreating something ancient, bringing it into the present as it is, mm-hmm. not changing it. So, mm-hmm. so in a sense, a painting participates in something like that. It doesn't change. Mm-hmm. The ritual is now frozen. You know, it's like mm-hmm. repeating Om. This is another Om, in other words, out mm-hmm. there. And that form's not going to change. Once it's painted, it's there.
It's there for good.
And in a way, we're mimicking nature, too. You know, you have nature creating, for instance, a zebra. And it keeps coming out the same. The zebra, 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 we call it species. Mm-hmm. But it's a kind of a natural ritual to create that form. Of course, each zebra's individual, but they sort of look like a zebra. They still...
You can still tell it's a zebra.
Yes, yeah, it's participating in that one thing.
Yeah, that
it's kind of remains present instead of disappearing. So it's anyway, you can play with these ideas and mm-hmm. and get carried away and go crazy if you want to with it. But
yeah, but that's the fun of art, isn't
that's
it?
That's right.
Yeah, that's right. We can talk about it till our...
Sure, you know, till you go till crazy.
Our mouths fall off. I've never seen anybody's mouth fall off.
No.
But we'll move ahead to the next one here.
Okay, this is a study 48 inches tall, again, oil. It's done of an image, a picture of my daughter, Anna. And it's called A to Z. She dropped the S in her pursuit of acting in Los Angeles, so her name is Szimhart. And so that's why I call it A to Z. Mm-hmm. But it's just a study of her and her energy. She's full of energy. She's her hair always changes color. At this point, it was red. Now it's black because she had a different role to play in some sort of a music video she was hired for, and they wanted her hair to be black. So she's got a very vibrant life, and I tried to reflect mm-hmm. that in the painting.
Well, you did pretty well here, too. She's a really, yeah. really pretty girl. How old is she?
24.
24? Same mm-hmm. same age as my daughter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. So that's Anna, A to Z.
Anna. Anna. You call her Anna,
Anna.
Too?
Anna. Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. That's my daughter's, well, Diana.
Diana, close.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, pretty close. All it's right. like that ah sound.
Yeah, you know, that's right.
Have that European sound to it. All right. Cute kid.
Now this one is called American Bison, and there was, again, inspired by an article I was reading and about how the herds are managed these days. So, mm-hmm. you know, I took a white, an image of a white buffalo sort of coming out of the canvas, and I tagged it because a lot of these herds are tagged now. They're not truly wild. They're managed, even though they're living in mm-hmm. the wild. Mm-hmm. And I threw these kind of cartoon characters, these line characters, into the... design. I've been using them lately in some of my paintings, these kind of linear figures. Mm-hmm. So there's cowboy type images with the cap on and guns in the blue section, and then there's a red images suggesting Indians mm-hmm. who hunted these for food. And so the, I don't know, it sort of looks like a flag-ish kind of a mm-hmm. image. You know, with the red, white, and blue, and mm-hmm, mm-hmm. suggestive of the history of this animal. And white, of course, suggests that it's a spiritual force within mm-hmm. the animal. This is the way the native or the First Nation people would have looked at a white buffalo as something significant in the spiritual world, as a changing of the era, or as some kind of an auspicious sign when one appeared.
Well, the spirit animal, your personal animal, there, your animus, or what it is that communicates to you from the nature, the mm, world of nature.
Like a totem animal.
A totem, yes,
right.
exactly.
Right.
Yeah. So and it, the blue and the white and the red. Yeah, it's actually a very political picture.
Yeah.
So so that's your work is kind of subliminal in a way.
Yeah, you know. Yeah, that one would be, I think. Mm-hmm. Again, that's 48 inches tall. It's oil mainly. There's some underpainting of acrylic to create a brown ground that I worked up from. So.
Yeah, very nice. So and these are all like painted sort of like you said before, really, really very quickly. Mm-hmm. So. Do you do any preparatory sketches with this stuff? Do you?
Yeah, I do. I do little thumb sketches. You know, they're like stamp size, 2x2 inch in a sketchbook, or maybe a little larger to kind of sort out what I'm trying to do. And then I might have this one, for instance, was typical. I did a quick layout of it, and then it. Sat for about a few days. I thought about it, and I had to change some of the anatomy. I got a few things wrong, you know, and so I repainted things. But once I figured out that I wanted to have these kind of cartoon line figures in it and where I wanted to put them, it went quickly because when I finish them, I want the brush strokes to look kind of fresh, and I don't want to belabor it. So that's been my style lately.
Nice.
Yeah, this one's Arab with bread, and again, it's 48 inches tall, oil mainly, with an acrylic ground. Mm-hmm. I started with the blue ground. This was in last year's show at the Goggle Works.
I remember this, yeah.
Yeah, so this again is politically inspired. I was thinking of the Middle East and the Arab Spring, and protesters in the Middle East will often wrap bread around their head or on their body. Bread, of course, is a symbol of life throughout the Middle East, the bread of life in Christianity and in Judaism and Islam, and
manna.
This is my body, you know. But it's very important to them, and when they wear it, it means that the government or the forces that be are taking life from them. They want their life back, their freedom. The horse represents freedom in the Middle East, and the Arab, of course, was developed as a breed in the day of Muhammad, and they had a particular way of running with the tail up and flowing in the wind, and that was called Muhammad's flag. But so the horse is sort of peering at us, the ancient spirit of the people along with the bread. And I did suggestive Arabic writing. The lines in there have nothing to do, they don't say anything in Arabic. Mm-hmm. They're just suggestive of that style of...
the calligraphy.
Right, calligraphy, that's all that is. I'm not trying to write anything. I'm just...
So there's no message? Yeah, hidden?
There's no hidden message. The message is hidden in the painting itself, because a lot of people look at this and go, what does that mean? Why would you put toast with a horse? So I said, this is one you might have to explain, but I had a good time with it. It is a little bit humorous, but at the same time, it has this undertow of a very serious message coming from.
Right, and it has that Wonder Loaf kind of shape to it, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
So that's like, that's pretty interesting. But people would have to know something about the history.
Right.
You know, that in order for them to really get the full impact of what this painting means. Do you like to explain what it means, or do you want the, need the viewer to more or less figure it out?
Both. I've had people come in my studio and it was hanging there and wondering what it was, why I did that, and normally I have to end up explaining it. I don't think, most of the people I've met don't know that when protesters in the Middle East wrap bread on them, why they do that. So what significance the bread would have. So you have to begin some kind of explanation.
Mm-hmm. They can't afford handkerchiefs.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Something. I don't know.
Something like
that. Yeah.
Poor joke.
Yeah. No. But they, sometimes, I mean, have you ever taught art history? I have, and some paintings are just obscure. Mm-hmm. You have to begin to set them in its time and why the painter did that kind of thing and why it's important. You've read The Painted Word by Tom Wolfe. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, he really does kind of a send-up of the modern era and how critics have to explain art for it to mean anything, because people look at this stuff and they walk back and they walk forward and they turn sideways and they mm-hmm. wonder, okay, what is Motherwell doing with all these slashes, or why is Pollock dripping paint, you know? Mm-hmm. There has to be a deeper psychological explanation for why this is a mm-hmm. $50 million painting today, you know?
So. Well, a lot of it has to do with the artist's intention. I mean, so, like, right. you know, because if the artist intends for it to be enigmatic, well, then that is a separate issue, because then the artist is more or less playing games, you think?
Well, it is a kind of a game. I mean, if you go to, like, Wittgenstein in philosophy, we play language mm-hmm. games all the time, but they should be mm-hmm. serious enough to have meaning and be honest and all of that. There should be some morals and ethics behind it. Mm-hmm. I think some people suspect that some artists were playing games with a lot of the work. Picasso mm-hmm. in point.
Yeah, you know, Picasso,
he even said yeah. not everything he painted was a Picasso, and people were still paying mm-hmm. lots of money for it. So, mm-hmm. yeah, you know, there's a tongue-in-cheek side to the art world, especially mm-hmm. when it comes to the high places.
Mm-hmm. Well, James Carroll said that Picasso didn't create anything. I mean, all he, you know, that, but he was so good at what he did that he just did it better than everybody else.
Right, yeah, yeah. He just kind of came, his energy just comes through his work. I mean, yeah. you can't deny that.
Oh, know. Yeah, Picasso's a brilliant artist, absolutely brilliant.
So, this is a kind of a takeoff on one of the artists I admire from my Santa Fe years was Fritz Scholder. This is my dog. It's an English Shepherd that I did in blue. So it's Arya mm-hmm. is her name. It's Arya in blue. And there's nothing really significant about this other than mm-hmm. it's got some bold color and this dog sort of watching. But these fields of color and things that Scholder was known for. Mm-hmm. So I thought that just this simple study of my dog, I had fun doing that one. Again, that's mm-hmm. that's an oil 48 inches tall.
Yeah, there's, it's kind of, Scholder was a fauvist, wasn't he?
In a way, Fritz Scholder, he had a big one-man show at the Smithsonian just a few years ago at the Indian mm-hmm. Museum down there. The Ready Museum has a Scholder. There, mm-hmm. but so he was painted like figures, usually figures in the center of the canvas, sometimes shamanic looking figures that look mm-hmm. kind of disturbing, with fields of color around them. That was That's what he was known for. Yeah,
I have to envision him in my mind.
He was inspired maybe somewhat by Francis Bacon, the artist, mm-hmm. A little bit of that. Yeah, so another one of these chairs. Looking at it from below, which is an unnatural place to be, as mm-hmm. if you're looking up from a glass ceiling, and this thing floating against the sky. So I sort of hurled this chair up and did a painting mm-hmm. of it. So
it's always good to get a different perspective.
Different perspective, again, yeah. suggestive of that. And again, it's just a... One of those paintings that I did without trying to stress anything political or philosophical, just kind of put it up there.
Mm-hmm. So it's kind of almost like color field painting in a way, with all of the surrounding, that powder blue and the expressive strokes around it. Mm-hmm. It's almost like a color field. It's it's interesting because of there is a lot of expressive abstraction that's taking place in places like New York and San mm-hmm. Francisco. And this kind of reminds me of that because of the unusual, the field of color and the centrally placed object that could or couldn't, that does or doesn't look like something. This one does look like something, mm-hmm. but, you know, it's the abstract composition and the way it's... the way you're looking at it, so it's almost like you're making a critique on the way you're looking at a painting.
Yeah, it's an unusual. I mean, usually when we see still lifes or objects, they're kind of at eye level on a shelf and mm-hmm. With a drapery and you know these classical still life thing. So this is a way of looking at still life that's not very still. Mm-hmm. It's in the air, and in a mm-hmm. sense, and you're looking up at it. So it's.
It's like it's hanging from
and
the
ceiling. And it's not a bird.
And it's not a bird.
Yeah. And it's still flying, sorry.
It's a bird, it's a plane, it's a chair. And we'll go to the next one. Do we have how many?
Oh, I had 24, I think, altogether.
Okay, well, we don't want to go too fast here.
Yeah. This is the billboard. It's up now. I just saw it up on Upper Fifth Street here, Fifth Street Highway. Mm-hmm. There was a contest earlier this year, the billboard contest, and I won the professional category, so I got a nice check. I did this painting, and this image is called Left 422. It's a place that I pass often coming to the Goggle Works from Birdsboro. And I thought this cacophony of signs stuck there to look at, to go left, was very interesting, and some of them are obviously unnecessary, but they're there, and so I did a study of it, 36 inches wide or so, and mm-hmm. and I submitted a portion of the painting in digitally for this contest, and it won. Mm-hmm. So I was kind of happy about that. I was surprised, and now that's I think there's another image of it as a billboard. You'll see it mm-hmm. here somewhere. Maybe it's not it. That's okay. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about it when it comes up.
Okay. Yeah, it was Fast Lane Art.
Fast Lane Art, yeah, they're the ones that do that every year. Yeah.
Every year.
And these billboards move, so I don't know where it is usually. Like it was before over on 422, now it's on Fifth Street. So
They keep them pretty active. Yeah. I noticed they have another one, the one about Frida Kahlo that's over on the Bingham Street Bridge. Yeah. And then I noticed that Miles DeCoster, who I had here a couple weeks ago,
right.
Had his that was hanging up on Lancaster Avenue.
Okay.
So, I mean, they're around. And
I guess they fill up empty billboards and, you know, it's a good thing.
Yeah. Well, it is a good thing.
I think it's a real good thing, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's
Movable art.
You know, a gallery that's out in the open that, you know,
right.
you get exposed to art, you know, just while you're driving your car. You get a chance to see something that's interesting and there it is. Right out there in the open.
Yeah, and it's not advertising anything more or less itself, but at least it's decorative in a sense, you know, have it up there. And
it's a great idea. Oh, I think so too. I think it's a wonderful idea.
Yeah.
So what about...
This one is my youngest daughter, who's now 18, and I did this study of her. It's, again, 48 inches tall. It's oil. Mm-hmm. And Lonnie is adopted from China. We brought her over from Hunan province when she was 11 months old, and she's fully Americanized now. She's a great kid. But in doing the study, I was thinking about in China, even today in rural places, they don't name daughters. It's daughter number one, daughter number two, daughter number three, and so forth. So there's been this issue of the one child per family in China for quite a while. That's mm-hmm. being lifted now since there's more prosperity there, right. where people can afford more kids.
Right.
But in general, if the first child for a lot of these families was a girl, they would give it up because it's bad luck. It's good luck to have a son. It's bad luck to have a daughter first in the superstitious part of the population. Mm-hmm. So as a result, all of these adoptions, many thousands of them that took place in the late 80s, 90s, and even, I don't know how much is going on now, 95% or more were girls. And so I just sort of did this daughter number three painting and that symbol of three on there, mm-hmm. kind of, again, a political statement using my own daughter in a sense, but although we gave her a real name. And in fact, the orphanage gave her a real name also. Her name is Hui Lan. Mm-hmm. When we adopted her, so she wasn't without a name from the beginning.
Oh, well, that's good.
Yeah,
I think they. You think that maybe China's changing in its.
Well, it depends on which demographic you live in, and you know, obviously the government is very suspicious of changes it can't control, mm-hmm. and for some reason, for instance, the book I wrote, Mushroom Satori, somebody mm-hmm. in Beijing tried to order it, and it was. Confiscated. They wouldn't let her have it in the country. So I don't mm-hmm. know why. It's about a Buddhist thing. But mm-hmm. Yeah, there's things happening in China which are changing. It's interesting, but the government still has that militaristic control and doesn't want to lose its power, obviously. Mm-hmm. However, since the communism has been loosening up, it's a lot of people in high office in China reverting back to some of their old folk traditions and folk beliefs, mm-hmm. what we call superstitions that existed prior to the atheist era. And some of them are getting called to task for that by others in the Communist Party. So there's things happening there. It obviously is very different in the way we approach politics here in the U.S. But they have a large middle class there now. That's as large, I think, as the population of the U.S. almost. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, they have, what is it, three times the amount of people over
there? Well, there's over a billion. Yeah. We have over 300,000, so yeah, over three times what we have. So, mm-hmm. But there's still a significant number of people that have old superstitions in that culture, and they don't go away easy.
Yeah.
Old rhino horn thing I was talking about.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, old ways die hard.
Right.
It's true. Even in America, you know.
We've
got to stop, training our children with certain things like prejudice and racism. And, you know, it's the kids are brought up with it, you know, almost subliminally, mm-hmm. where it's just that, you know, all they do is absorb the attitude of their parents and their relatives and that. And, and it just perpetuates it. It's got to be a grassroots attempt to get this sort of negative training out of there, so we all treat each other like equals.
Yeah, and I think artists can add to that. I mean, there have been obviously the artists that do political cartoons do an enormous good in spreading ways of. Exposing racism and ethnic bias and all of that kind of thing. I mean, we saw, for instance, in the long years that Doonesbury, mm-hmm. Gary Trudeau, mm-hmm. he's just one. But that's one way an artist can affect the way people mm-hmm. view themselves. Comedians, of course, it's another mm-hmm. another art form. Mm-hmm. But they do a tremendous make us laugh at our own foibles. Make fun of being racist.
Yeah.
And in a way that exposes it and brings it out in the open and the dialogue begins and then the healing can begin. So, but if we keep it secret or keep it quiet or keep it traditional, so to speak, mm-hmm. it doesn't go away.
Well, yeah, then it's all it's doing is subduing it and pushing it under.
Yeah. So in a way, the painting has a tinge of that in it, kind of to remind us that some of this still exists. But it's also tongue-in-cheek because he is daughter number three to me.
So, okay. She's my third
daughter. So mm-hmm. there's this humor involved in painting that the way I did.
And your middle daughter, what's her name?
Anna. That's Anna.
The oldest is
Nadia.
Is Nadia.
Okay. Yeah, she's in Australia. She's a teacher.
Okay. I didn't want to leave her out.
I've done a lot of studies of her in the past. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. This one, dragonfly with these three figures under umbrellas under it, is a juxtaposition of form and creatures. So you can look at it several ways, I think. The dragonfly could be very close to you and these creatures very far, mm-hmm. or it could be all on the same plane and the dragonfly is quite large and ominous.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so. The model I used for this painting was a dried-up dragonfly I found in a Philadelphia parking garage. I was with my cousin from Australia, and her symbol is a dragonfly, and it's her only tattoo. And so when we saw that, I kept it and put it in my studio, and she said that she wanted me to do a painting of a dragonfly sometime. So I kind of looked at this dried-up thing. I pasted it up on the wall, and I... came up with this idea,
mm-hmm.
Kind of again in that same style I work in, and just thought about it could symbolize mythically a coming storm and people are mm-hmm. walking with umbrellas, you know, or it dragonflies also can represent good fortune in the Orient, so it could mean something, a blessing coming. It depends how you look at it. It can mm-hmm. look mm-hmm. dangerous, it can look holy, it can look
Yeah, it has some, well, I mean, depends on your point of view. It could be menacing if you look at it in that way. Because I mean, if you don't have the idea, I mean, I'm taking it as a perspective, a change of perspective. Like, mm-hmm. you're actually looking at the three figures in the background holding the umbrellas, and the dragonfly comes in front of you, you know, 3 inches in front of your face, and right. you see it like that, and the figures are like in the distance. But when you put it in the form of a painting, mm-hmm. the painting flattens everything.
Yes, I mean, it's like cubism.
Like right. they want to see all of the angles of the object that you're looking at, as if you opened it up and folded it out.
Right.
You know. So this kind of has that same effect where you're distorting the perspective of what you're looking at by squashing it. Everything, you know, the foreground and the background mm-hmm. have no separation, and they're right there. Which is really interesting, because there's no change in the texture of the paint either. It seems that, you know, that everything is painted with the same intensity, the same thickness of paint, the same brush stroke style, everything all at once. So it's an interesting little play of ideas there.
Mm-hmm. So, if you like dragonflies, it might mean more. I don't know.
Yeah, if you like dragonflies, you still own this painting?
Yes, I have that one.
Okay, it's for sale, folks.
It is for sale. And that, again, that's 48 inches tall. I was working in that format quite a bit, mm-hmm. 48 by 36.
Yeah. It's a nice size, though.
I can still transport it in my car.
Yes.
That's important to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I'm getting more involved with the smaller works anyway, but you're getting involved with some larger works too.
I'd like to get bigger if I could, but yeah. Maybe one of these days I'll do another mural if I come up with an idea somewhere. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's, either or. It's however one likes to paint. Mm-hmm. But personally, I've been going for a small scale because it just, I don't know, it just, the larger you work, it presents a whole different set of
problems. If you notice what these paintings I do, like this one, I want them in a sense to be seen across the room. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can see what it is. You don't have to mm-hmm. walk up too close to find out. Mm-hmm. And so that kind of, I don't know why that's important to me, but somehow that's, a lot of these paintings are like that. Not all of them, of course.
Well, it's interesting too, because you use such dynamic color.
Right, that's the other idea.
The other thing is that, I mean, this is not really natural color. I mean, the natural color that I see is this remarkable shading within the upper body and the head of the dragonfly, because that just really...
Yeah, there's an iridescence to them if you see them up close, and the color just bounces all over, especially mm-hmm. around swampy areas, mm-hmm. you know, whether it's reflected from the water. So I wanted to throw some of that in there. I just thought that's intriguing. But
well, it looks, but it's your eye deceives you when you look mm-hmm. at it, because it looks, I mean, really, it's just a couple of dabs.
Yeah, well, that's the idea behind painting, I guess, trompe l'oeil, how do you pronounce it?
Trompe l'oeil,
yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, fool the eye. But again, you know, with the Impressionists especially, we found that dabs of color, not meant to fool the eye, but meant to enrich the experience of looking at real things mm-hmm. in an atmospheric sense. What is the atmosphere doing to it? And, mm-hmm. you know, rather than painting the solid object, looking at the way the atmosphere interacts with it and your eye, and mm-hmm. in other words, you're looking for a different dimension, a different phenomenology, so to speak.
Yes, phenomenology.
Regarding the painting. Yeah,
because
yeah.
it's a different kind of experience.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so this is even pushing it maybe a little further into almost like a cartoon that's still using expressionist color.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I guess it has that oriental flatness to it.
Well, yeah, and I also kind of wonder sometimes how one of these things would, you would react to it if you just painted just the color field, just the field itself, because mm-hmm. so much of the painting is involved with brushwork, like all of the yellow and the orange in the background. It just seems like it stands out on its own. In fact, if it didn't have that background color, the objects inside of it would not be as pronounced.
Right.
But it's a great juxtaposition use.
When I used to teach, I tried to get students that they would concentrate so much on the subject, whatever it was, and they'd forget the negative space, mm-hmm. how important it is mm-hmm. to support a painting. I try to make those brush strokes as strong as the positive space, and mm-hmm. And give it a sense of substance. Mm-hmm. And I think it helps the overall design, mm-hmm. And it's finished. But yeah, the negative space is sometimes forgotten that it's important. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, I remember being taught that even the most insignificant part of the painting is still important as part of the painting.
Yeah.
I mean, the upper right corner, is the same as the lower left.
Right.
So it's like if you don't give that, if you don't give everything on the field of the canvas or whatever you're painting on that same amount of attention, mm-hmm. Then you're actually, wasting the surface.
Right.
Because of the...
But what's interesting about what you're saying is by leaving it alone, for instance, in Chinese watercolor mm-hmm. landscape painting, they use the idea of dragon lines and also negative space. In other words, what's not there in that way of looking at that art is more important than what's there. So it kind of reverses how we look at things in the Western sense, but they're still using negative space in a very powerful way by putting nothing there.
Mm-hmm.
And our eye draws connections, which they call dragon lines. So there's very important placement, and these dragon lines create a sense of composition. They're mm-hmm. not there, you can't see them, but the energy, the force of that sort of thing is there. It's a Taoist way of for instance, mm-hmm. looking at design, rather than our sometimes more Western ways of actually drawing the lines in. They don't draw the lines in.
Well, the lines of direction. I mean, the energy between the objects, that, the relationship between part A and part B.
Yeah. When you mentioned cubism earlier, it was filled with lines. It's all filled with lines. Oh, there's the billboard itself. You can see it, that we saw the painting earlier. Mm-hmm. And this is when it was on 422, actually. The left 420 was only about two mm-hmm. miles from the actual turnoff.
Now this was Fast Lane Art, which is promoted by the Berks Arts Council.
Yes,
and they hold this competition every year, where they take six winners that are juried by the by a chosen person to be placed on these billboard sized, they're 14 by 22 feet.
Right,
so it's pretty large. And it takes place every year. So it's three students and three professionals.
Right.
So you were one of the professionals.
I won the professional category. Yeah, I got first mm-hmm. in that. But what I had to explain to people was, no, I did not do a painting that big.
Yeah.
Because, again, perception is incredible when it comes to the arts.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't realize that what happened here is they take a digital image, blow it up on vinyl, and the vinyl gets put up mm-hmm. on there. But some of the people I talked to thought that I had to paint something that big to put it up there. So.
Yeah. Just let them think that.
Yeah,
so,
I could have.
So did you paint that big? Yeah.
Yeah, left-handed.
Yeah, left-handed, right. Mm-hmm.
So, and this is one of a series of about 15 paintings I did that were 12 inches by 8 inches, the small canvases. I bought a bunch of them. And I was playing with this idea when I first got the Goggleworks studio, and I just wanted to work on technique.
Mm-hmm.
So I grabbed this idea, which I like the turtle. It's a great image. I've always liked it for its symbolic value. Mm-hmm. For instance, the Lenni Lenape people in this area, their totem was the turtle. Mm-hmm. They were the turtle clan. So these box turtles, when I see them around, I always think of the Indian spirit here, the First Nations,
mm-hmm.
and how they felt about the turtle. So in this case, I used kind of a ghostly image of a turtle underwater with this feather floating above it, and I did variations on this theme that are mm-hmm. kind of quirky, but this is just one of them I threw in there.
Well, the shadow, I mean, it is very ethereal. because you don't know if it's underwater or not. It's,
you're not sure. It could be in the air. Yeah.
It could be in the air, or that the feather is floating, or it could be symbolic. You know.
Sure.
And it is symbolic, but right. It's, you know, it's not representationally symbolic.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of like a shield, mm-hmm. in some sense, but it's not. You know, there is a sense of could be a natural image of a white turtle with a mm-hmm. feather floating in the water above it. You know, you could suggest all kinds of things with it, but mainly I was interested in technique and the ideas that came up. I mean, I did mm-hmm. Turtles with keys. I did one that was in the style of I forget his name now. He's got work in the Philadelphia Art Museum. It'll come to me later. Mm-hmm. But I tried to mainly work on technique, on brush technique, and mm-hmm. by doing a whole series of these. And that I liked. I liked the idea of this loose style that I started mm-hmm. to work with. So
that is the white in the turtle's body there mm-hmm. is painted.
It's painted white. It's actually white paint. Yeah.
Okay, so it's not it's not like subtracted from the...
No.
Yeah.
No, it's all painted in. Again, this one was done for an autumn show last year. It was at the Studio B Gallery, and mm-hmm. Halloween, obviously. But I didn't do it for Halloween originally. I heard this song, I guess people have heard, I Shot the Sheriff. Mm-hmm, I should mm-hmm. have shot the deputy, and I was thinking of the idea. Mm-hmm. So I had a hat, and I had this cowboy hat in my studio, and I started with the hat, and I did a study of, and I put this scarecrow under it and put an arrow through it, and I call it hat pin. Mm-hmm. So, you know, using the arrow to sort of keep the hat from blowing off the scarecrow in the wind. Mm-hmm. And, but again, I kind of played with the composition and the color, and it was a lot of fun to do something like that.
And, I think there's a lot of humor in it as well, too. Mm-hmm. Aside, well, like you were saying earlier about comedy being able to say something, mm-hmm. you know, the scarecrow has all kinds of different...
Well, right. We call it the straw man.
The straw man.
We set up a straw man and we shoot it. You know, this could be race. It could be political. I mean, you often hear this in the pundits in mm-hmm. Democrats and Republicans and independents. They'll set up a straw man and talk about that version of a Democrat or that version of a Republican, mm-hmm. as if they're all like that.
Well, I like sheriff. I like the sheriff badge on there.
Yeah, I put a sheriff badge on.
Let's see, we have 3 minutes here.
Okay, let's go through.
Okay.
Well, this one's one of the more recent ones. Again, I used that stick figure, and it's an idea of horsepower. But here, again, the human being is small, the horse is big. And, you know, we depend on things we control and make to make us bigger mm-hmm. and to make us more powerful. And so I kind of use that as a takeoff in this. Mm-hmm. combination of a running figure with the horse, with the energy of the horse. Mm-hmm. And I did the horse again very loosely. You know, I used my finger actually to rub out paint to do the hair.
Is this a smaller work?
No, it's 36 inches wide mm-hmm. and 24 inches high. Yeah. So it's the idea.
I like it. It does have a little bit of that sort of German feel to it, though. You know, German expressionist.
Okay. Yeah, good.
But it's nice. I can see, like, you know, Middendorf and some others in here. Mm-hmm.
Now, this one sold a couple years ago to a young man. His mother bought it for him as a graduation gift. But I had an image of this just driving to the studio, this idea of this lamb with this lion, and I could see this white form mm-hmm. on a black form, and I just quickly painted it. I mean, this one only took me about a day to sort mm-hmm. this out, and it kind of just worked, you know, as a mm-hmm. the lion and the lamb. And this is Moth Dream. I saw a moth in my yard, and I kind of did a study of the moth, and then put a cartoon-like caterpillar, kind of dreaming itself in the future.
Mm-hmm.
That's a smaller painting. It's 16. I think it's about 14 inches wide. Yeah.
I really like your brushwork. This is really nice.
And this is that one in acrylic I did. It's up at the gallery now in the Goggle Works, and it's a big painting. It's almost 6 feet wide. It's two myths combined into one, Noah and Moby, and Noah's Ark floating above Moby Dick, and you can do anything you mm-hmm. want to with that in your mind, but the idea is that there's danger in the ocean, mm-hmm. and water is danger in Noah. It's a killer.
Mm-hmm.
But for Moby Dick, for the whale, this is life. underwater. Yeah. It's where he lives. It's where he enjoys life. It's mm-hmm. where, you know, and yet we project these death images onto this.
Well, I think it's the whole thing of Noah's Ark is supposed to be the idea that you're taking two animals of every kind, putting it onto the ark so that it survives the so-called Holocaust the flood, right? And it does, and that is and that in a way there's a certain bit of irony because that whale will never fit on into the ark, you know. You can't. Some animals you just can't take along, you know.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, we've just been given the goodbye signal,
okay.
and as much as I regret calling this to quits, we have to say goodnight. But anyway, I want to thank you. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you for inviting me.
Oh, thank you for joining me.
It was fun.
I love it. Yeah, I wish we had more time. So anyway, thank you very much for joining us tonight. This is New Arts Alive. I'm Ron Schira. And this is Joe Szimhart. Thank you very much. Have a good night.
NAP Connection originates from the Berks Community Television Studio in Reading, PA, airing live on the fourth Tuesday of the month at 9 p.m. Check your local listings for repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program, call 610-683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530, or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown. Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5 p.m., Saturday, 10 to 2 p.m., or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.